what you got to say. Go on, tell
you. You know, last Sunday,
right,
we're at church. Uh-huh. And you talking to that little boy, them two little bad boys that's in our church.
Yeah, I remember.
You know we got these two little bad children in our church.
Yes, yes, yes.
We're still after church.
Yes, they will.
God gonna get them. But you know, last Sunday, Ram said, "Where is God?" Looked him right in the eye, said, "Where is God?" The little boy stood back, didn't answer. He said, "I said, where is God?" The little boy got so upset, he ran out the church and went and found his little brother. He said, "Brother, we in trouble. God is missing and they think we done took it."
Like this morning, we some, the old songs. We're not dealing with this new genre, I guess that's the way to pronounce it, of music. A new rule book, a new good book. We are going by the book that has been here since the eons of time. This is a great church because it is a place where the Savior is exalted. We exalt Jesus Christ. We're not a haughty, exalted people that walk around looking out and down at everyone. We are a people that believe in Jesus Christ. And we know that where we are here because of Jesus Christ.
Right.
We don't have a new rule book or a new good book. You know, any of us in here that read a lot, and I read in a specialty after the election of the vice president, the president, I'm talking about Uncle Donald, there, everybody that had never written a book before wrote one. And I tried to read the majority of them, tried to squeeze them in with my Christian reading. This is a great church because where it is a place where Jesus is exalted. On Christ, the solid rock, we lean. Oh, we realize everything else is sinking sand. Where the saints are exalted, we find almost the 4 years that I have been here. Right. When I got here, I was wondering. I had known Dr. Palmer for a few years. Right. I got here in the late 80s. Right. And I knew when he was over at next to West Shore, that's where I first visited him at. I was wondering what kind of church I would find. Now, almost 4 years later, I can tell you what kind of church I found. I found a church solid in the doctrine, solid in the teachings, solid in the way we used to worship God down in the country, down in Anson County, how we used to ride out and visit the church on Sunday. I had such an imprint on my life that I remember the third week of August was our revival Sunday. I remember the Sunday when the Saturday before that Sunday, when they took me to the liquid grave, as we refer to it as, where they netted the pine needles off of the swimming pool there, Brother K-Mac, so you could get down in there. And when they plunged you down in the liquid grave, and you came up, the scripture said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. When I came up, I didn't look any different. I didn't act any different. But there was a difference in me. I was 18, I believe I was. But there was something new in my life. The things I used to do. The way I used to act. I didn't act that way anymore. Because I know I had been touched by the Lord. And the Lord was with me. When I got here, I found a church that was hungry, hopeful, happy, healthy. I had found a people who was willing and able to go where God wanted to take them. I found a church made up of great people, serving a great God. I will say it again, University Memorial Baptist Church is a great church. I'm glad to be part of it because your pastor, when I told him I would love to join his congregation, he said, "Well, Doc, I got a spot for you." He said, "You're going to be my director of Christian education." And it was like he had been praying, and the Holy Spirit had told him, "Say, that's what this guy liked. Right. That's what he really liked." And I want to preach to a great congregation from a great passage of Scripture. I want to share a thought that has gripped my heart in these days. I want you to know that as great as this church is, it can be even greater. And you may not know it, but your pastor, he has us working toward that. Sometimes this year, I guess it was around the first part of the year, when the virus was, it kind of had a little hold on it. He said, "Doc, say, you know, we've been closed for a while." And he said, "Select a subject that we can do a study together in church school." And I was so elated, I didn't want the pastor to deceive me, but I was jumping, you know. So my response to him was, "Pastor, do you have any guidelines?" He said, "No." I said, "Well, Pastor, you know, you turn in, me loose, you give me the freedom to execute what I believe in." But he was gracious, he was nice. He said, "Well, Doc, go ahead." So we're doing this personal evangelism. We're learning to go how to go out and evangelize the world. And we're learning how to do it the proper way. See how this man here that I support wholeheartedly, and the deacons and the trustees and the members, I really enjoy. And so I want to attempt to preach to you this morning from this great passage of Scripture. "If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray." I want to talk about prayer a little bit this morning. my wife, this week, I told her I had to preach him now. She tried to find out what I was going to preach about. But I was able to keep that. I think I kept it. She passed by my where I was standing at. She probably eagle-eyed. She saw that where I was looking at. She probably said, "Oh." And when I go back in my office back there, she would come back and look at the door. Oh, and she like she had wanted to carry on a conversation. But I want to talk to you for a few moments about prayer. The scriptures say, man, and that scripture is written in the masculine gender, that's why you see man, but woman, people to cure that, should always pray. And die, grow faint. Not grow weak. Not lose heart. Because when they don't see the prayer being answered, they stop praying. University Memorial, we're just recovering from this virus. Not only did it devastate this city of Charlotte, it did the whole world. So, what we need to do, we need to pray. Right. If you remember that at 9-1-1, what happened when those aircraft flew into the Twin Towers in New York City? When one went down in South Delaware, I believe it was, the churches, they started opening up. And they started going out to prayer. Even it was all right to talk about prayer. It is all right. It was all right to even pray. It was even all right to say the name of Jesus. But once we got through that dilemma and God delivered us, God gave us the victory, we were back in the same predicament that we were in once before, where you could no longer use the name of Jesus in certain cases because it was not politically correct. But I serve a God that is God over the politician. Yeah. He's a God over the whole wide world. Yeah. He's God even over those individuals that threw those aircraft into the Twin Towers in New York, right, trying to wreck our world economy. But did it work? No. Because it was not in the time that God has established that He will return.
All right.
And I believe that if we go into our secret closet, see, it says man should always pray and not grow weary. When you pray and you get down and you pray on a Monday and you don't get an answer by Tuesday, you want to stop. You want to say, well, God is not going to answer my prayer. But God wanted us to be our people here at University Memorial. I am praying that God will send us members. That's why I am glad we are going to be going out very shortly, evangelizing. We are going to go in this all this area around here. And we are going to tell people about the love of God. How God has his hand around us. How God loves us. How God loves everyone in the world. For God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten Son. And he didn't send him down here to be a lover of some of us. He loved us. Yes. The scriptures say God commended his love to us when we were yet sinners.
Right.
For he sent Jesus Christ to be that propitiation, to be that one that would stand in the gap, that would make everything right.
All right.
And bring us back into right relationship with him. This day, I want you to think of me and every morning around 6 o'clock. I sometimes get up early. But at 6 o'clock, just when you wake up, just before you have any breakfast or anything, go have a place in your residence where you can go and talk to him. See, God wants us, he wants us to talk to him. He wants to hear our voice. And what I like about that time in the morning, it's all quiet. And the scripture says that he that keepeth Israel, and we are the people of God of this day, he's not going to sleep with some. You know, if you call me, people call me and say, well, Dr. Little, I can't get you. Your mailbox is full. Yes, Pastor. But with one thing I like about prayer, the connect line is the Holy Spirit. And it's never down. We can go in there and say, Father, in the name of your Son Jesus, I'm sure God, Jesus, the Son of the living God, is sitting on high, waiting for us to come. You know, in there in Acts, it tells us, say that whosoever call upon the name of the Lord, you shall be saved. Now, you can't be saved and you can't even have a really intimate conversation with a lot of your friends. But he that keepeth Israel, the Holy Spirit is not a tattletale. He's going to be recipient of that message and forward it on to the Father. And the Father go smile and say, my word, it's being promulgated. and he's going to look over here at University Memorial, and he's going to say, I've got a membership on that, the church, the Ecclesia.
All right,
that's the kid I always kid me about that. That's the church.
Yeah.
That is a Greek word for the church. And he called us out. And he has us sit aside. He, because there's no other word, there's nothing we can do under the face of this great world we live in whereby we might be saved. We only saved by the blood of Jesus Christ and the sacrifice he made when he went to Calvary. And I ask that you wake up in the mornings and you join me. You know, down in the country where I was reared, we got up early anyway. So let's revert back to that. Just get up. See, because God wanted us to pray to him with heartfelt prayers. It's good when we come out here and we pray together. That's good. But there may be some things that you want to talk to the Heavenly Father about that you don't want to live here. And we know if we go into our secret garden, and that's what he said. He said, don't be left to hypocrites that stand on the street corner. And we have some people that like to go to church, and they don't pray till they get to church because they want to be. They want to acclimate claim of a man. They want, oh, you know, he can really pray. But the scripture says, when you pray, go into your secret closet.
All right.
Say, and the Father who sees you in your closet. And when you come out of your closet, and I see Deacon K-Mac wave at it, I don't know. I don't have to tell him that, you know, I just come out of praying. Because that means I am looking for a paddleboard, pat on the back.
Yeah.
But if you pray in secret, he's going to bless you in the public, where everybody will know. I know myself, and I'm going to cut this short. I don't want to be long with you. But I come from a very poor family. I used to be ashamed to admit it. But my mom and my dad, they were both illiterate. Mom could write, as they would say in Japan, the Scotia. But I made up my mind that I wasn't going to be that way. And God helped me not to be that way.
Right.
And, you know, I know when I got here, Dr. Farmer was introducing me to the congregation, And he said, Dr. Newman, say he got some papers on the wall. He said, Aaron papers. Yeah. Say, but he's not snooty, arrogant. I'm not that way, because I count it a blessing.
Amen.
I say, if it wasn't for God,
yeah,
I wouldn't be here today. If it wasn't for God that reached down and touched me and made a way for me to be where I am today.
Yeah.
He said, men ought to always pray.
Right.
And that grow faint. And I haven't stopped praying till today. And I'm not going to stop praying.
Right.
Because I enjoy that time in the morning. When it's nice and quiet,
yes,
when I can reach out and he reaches out and touch me,
yes,
and whisper into my ear, and I can tell him, Lord, I thank you.
Yes,
I humbly submit myself unto you.
Yes.
Lord, reach down and touch me, Lord. Make me bold, Father.
Yeah.
Teach me about evangelism. Give me a heart to reach out and touch people that don't know you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That you are the way, the truth, and the life.
Yeah.
No one can come unto you unless they enter by Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that at the name of Jesus, every tongue must confess.
Yeah.
Every knee must bow.
Yeah.
And I thank you, Lord,
yeah,
for being so good. Lord, teach us to pray.
All right.
All right. Lord, teach us to pray. Teach us to be the people that will turn from our wicked ways and stay in the shade out of the sun and do those things that are pleasing unto you. Father, we ask that you give us an appetite and a desire to read about you, because during the time of Pentecost, the first three chapters of Acts, and it was stated, Peter said, silver and gold we don't have.
Right.
Say, but what I have,
right,
he said, and that's Jesus. See, it doesn't cost anything for Jesus.
Yeah.
It's free.
Yeah.
All you have to do is prepare your heart.
Sir.
Prepare your heart. Father, I thank you for the opportunity that you have granted me this day to preach to serve a great group of people. Father, a great congregation, a great pastor, a great co-pastor. Father, yours truly, that has been chosen to be the dispenser of your word. Father, I love you, and I thank you in the name of